So let's take a moment to discuss the key differences between molecular orbital theory and valence bond theory. So in valence bond theory, we said that bonding was localized between atoms, and that's just not the case in molecular orbital theory. So we would say that a single bond of a carbon-carbon bond may look like this, where we said that the overlap, say we have ethane, the overlap of two sp3 orbitals is localized in the middle between the two. And then this was called a sigma bond. It's got cylindrical symmetry in the middle between two atoms. We could have a pi bond. In addition to this, if we had a double bond to a carbon, and so we'd have the sigma bond in the middle, and then additionally, we'll just show separately here, we'd have these p orbitals of carbon. Here the py orbital is emphasized. And we'd say that the overlap is between the two above and below. So this would be what a pi bond would look like according to valence bond theory. Now molecular orbital theory would disagree, and it would say that molecular orbitals exist throughout the entire molecule, not just in between two atoms. And so we have this concept of bonding and antibonding. And with bonding orbitals, what we have are the constructive interference of atomic orbitals. So just like two ocean waves that may come together and double in size if they are in phase with one another, you might add these two together and come together constructively. What we have is orbitals such as the s orbital of hydrogen that come together with the s orbital of hydrogen, and we constructively combine these two together to make a molecular orbital that looks much like an addition of the two. It's constructive interference of the wave functions of the orbital. Okay, and we're in phase with one another. With the hydrogen atom, we can pick one phase or the other, and we'll see that in a moment, but s orbitals only have one phase at a time, and so if we bring them together in phase, the same color as one another, we get the bonding sigma molecular orbital. Okay, they're lower in energy relative to comprising atomic orbitals, as we'll see in a minute. And the lowest energy overall is when all s orbitals in a molecule are in phase with one another. Okay, so sigma bond looks like this. Antibonding orbitals, on the other hand, are destructive interference. They're out of phase interaction, just like two ocean waves might be out of phase with one another. Okay, and so we would actually have downward peaks here in the places that we have ups, and when we add those together, we would get a flat line, nothing, like the big wave we see cancels out before it actually gets to us and the waves go away at the beach. Okay, destructive interference out of phase, and we have more nodes. With the hydrogen atom, this looks like two hydrogen atoms coming together, one of which is out of phase with the other. And so like I said before, hydrogen has to pick a phase, whether it picks one phase or the other, the plus or minus phase, which has nothing to do with charge. It's a mathematical construct of waves. And so we can pick either, you know, plus or minus, and I'm using colors to denote in phase or out of phase or one phase or the other. So we just say they don't match. That means they cancel out where they touch. And so as we bring the hydrogen atom together into the hydrogen molecule, our molecular orbital is going to have a node in the middle. We're going to cancel out that area in between the atoms where they are closest together, and we will form an antibonding orbital that has a nodal plane down the middle of the molecule, and we'll have out of phase interaction there. And so this is an antibonding orbital that's worse, higher in energy relative to the atomic orbitals that bring it together, and all s orbitals out of phase or all p orbitals out of phase, as we will see in later examples, can be the highest energy molecular orbital. And you have to kind of do the calculation to see which is which, but it'll be a candidate for that highest energy molecular orbital. And so that leaves us with a few steps that you can just kind of jot down, and we'll do an example here in a moment. But what we're going to do for constructing the molecular orbital diagram is we will mix atomic orbitals together, and we'll list them on the left or the right and leave a space in the middle. and the orbitals should be labeled. Example, we label the 1s orbital. We want to arrange orbitals vertically by relative energy. S orbitals are lower than p orbitals for the most part, and electronegative atoms have lower energies than electropositive atoms because they can handle electrons better than their electropositive counterparts. And then we want to draw the MOs in the middle, lower in energy for the bonding MO, lower than the lowest atomic orbital. And then we want to draw the antibonding MO higher than the highest atomic orbital. And then we want to label those as sigma or pi bonding with a star if we have an antibonding orbital. And then we want to fill with the valence electrons. So let's look at the simplest example. Let's look at hydrogen. We want to bring the 1s orbital in from a hydrogen. So we bring two equivalent energy orbitals together, and we want these to mix to form molecular orbitals, so we'll draw the bonding sigma orbital that we just drew above, slightly lower in energy, or lower in energy than the atomic orbital. So here's our energy axis, zero energy here. The atomic orbitals have no interaction with each other at the zero line, and so bonding has a delta E that is negative, and so this is a favorable interaction. If we have a delta E that's positive for the sigma star that we drew above the antibonding orbital, we'll redraw it here with an out of phase interaction. It's higher in energy than both the atomic orbitals, and so it has a delta E relative to the atomic orbitals that's positive, so it's an unfavorable interaction. And so then we connect the orbitals to indicate that we're mixing them together in case we have more orbitals that we're mixing in larger diagrams. Okay, so we connect those together, and really and truly we're considering the orbitals in the middle for the molecular orbitals. So the molecular orbitals are in the box here. They are in the middle. The atomic orbitals on the outside. So what else do we have to do? We have to indicate what electrons are coming together from the atomic orbitals. And so each hydrogen, a single dot for its dot structure, we bring two together. We form one bond according to valence bond theory from our Lewis structure. And so two electrons can fit in a single orbital. That sigma bonding orbital fills for hydrogen. Okay, two electrons in, and if we had a third electron, we'd have to put it in up here, but we don't for the hydrogen atom. So this is H2, and that's equal to H to H. Okay, last thing is bond order. And so bond order is going to equal the number of bonding electrons minus the number of antibonding electrons, and all of this over 2. And so for the hydrogen atom, we have 2 in a bonding orbital. Okay, there they are right there. And then we have 0 in an antibonding orbital. And so 2 divided by 2 is 1, which matches our Lewis structure for one bond. So we agree there. Okay, and so we'll do another video for more examples of more complicated molecular orbital theory problems. However, this is good for us getting started here.